Right, and people have stopped arriving, so let's welcome our speaker, Felix Finster from the University of Regensburg, and today he will talk to us on a positive mass theorem for static causal fermion system. And the usual thing I have to say is that we are recording this and we will cut out the earlier informal discussion before the meeting. We keep the discussion about the science at the end in there, but if you've posed a question and you don't want it to be in the recording, please just send us an email and then we will cut it out. And now we look forward to the lecture of Felix Finster.
Also, thank you very much, Gerhard, for the invitation, or I should thank Carla Zederbaum for the invitation, of course. So it's a great pleasure to be here. Of course, it's a bit sad to be there only via the internet, but that's better than nothing. And well, maybe before beginning, I want to, let's see, so I want to point out that this is, I'm reporting on joint work with Andreas Platzer, who finished his PhD with me last summer and who is now working for a big company in Munich. And let me first of all recall like the standard ADM mass. I mean, probably most of you are familiar with it, but just to set the stage, to fix the notation and so on. So the ADN mass is defined as follows. So we consider the following setting. So we consider globally hyperbolic Lorentzian manifold, which is always four dimensional. We assume that it's static. So this means that there's a time function little t, which gives like a global foliation of space time. And the d by dt vector field is a Killing field, which is orthogonal to the surfaces t equal to constant. And then one just considers one of these cushy surfaces N and the corresponding induced Riemannian metric on this three-dimensional surface. And now we assume that this Riemannian manifold is asymptotically flat, which means that there is a compact set K such that N minus K is diffeomorphic to R3 minus a closed ball. So this gives a specific chart near infinity. And in this chart, the metric should be as follows. So the metric tensor should be the Euclidean metric plus a correction term. And this correction should decay like one over the distance, like the Newtonian potential. And the first and second derivative should decay appropriately one order in the ray in the distance faster. And under these assumptions, the ADM mass is defined by taking these combinations of first derivatives of the metric, integrating them over spheres of radius capital R, where this new alpha is just the normal in the coordinate chart. The omega is the area measure on the surface, on the sphere. And then one takes the limit where R goes to infinity. So this defines quantity, the ADM mass, which corresponds to, or which gives you the total energy and matter content of your static universe. Okay, so this is like the standard ADM mass. And now the goal of the talk is to explain you a different notion of mass, where also the setting is quite different. And I want to explain in which sense this new notion corresponds to the ADM mass or generalizes the ADM mass. And I will also report on a corresponding positive mass theorem. And before beginning, I should say that, I mean, as always in math and physics, there are different levels of understanding. First of all, there's kind of an abstract understanding where you just see what look at the different mathematical objects, you look how they are defined and you study their properties and relations. And then there's a deeper understanding where one sees what these objects mean, why the objects were introduced the way they were introduced. And finally, there's a more direct or intuitive understanding where one sees what these objects mean physically, why do they correspond to other objects which I'm already familiar with, or why do they just correspond to physical quantities? Well, and of course, I don't want to say more on that. I just want to point out that in the limited time I have, I won't be able to explain you all levels of understanding. So, but what I want to do is I want to begin abstractly so that you see purely mathematically what the mass is, what the total mass is, which I will define. And then I will make the connection to the ADM mass and explain our positive mass theorem. And of course, like a more profound understanding takes time, and I will just give you a few references at the end. And I should also say, I mean, in case of question, always feel free to interrupt me or to ask questions. I'm happy for any feedback. Okay, now let's begin just abstractly. What is the setup and what is the mass? Okay, here's where we start. So we consider G, so this is a locally compact and sigma compact Hausdorff space. So just a topological space. And on this topological space, there is a function L defined, the Lagrange, and more precisely, it's a mapping from G cross G to the positive real numbers, including zero, which is symmetric. So if we exchange the two arguments, it doesn't change. Then for simplicity of presentation, we assume that it's continuous and pointwise bounded, and moreover that it has compact range, which means that if I fix one argument, L of X, and the other one is free, then the resulting function should have compact support on G. And now I consider two radon measures on G. So what is a radon measure? So this is a positive regular Borel measure, which is the measure of any compact set should be finite. Well, and Borel measure simply is a measure on the sigma algebra generated by all the open sets. So this is why we have a topological space here. So there's a collection of open sets, and the Borel algebra is like the algebra generated by these open sets. Okay, so now we have like two measures, and we can also introduce corresponding supports. So capital N is the support of the measure mu, and N tilde is the support of mu tilde. And the support is, intuitively speaking, these are all the points where the measure is non-zero, and here I wrote the detailed definitions in case you are not familiar with it. And now we want to compare these two measures. So the idea is to compare the measures mu and mu tilde asymptotically near infinity. What does this mean? So this more specifically, we take an exhaustion of N by compact sets, and we choose an exhaustion omega N tilde of N tilde, again by compact sets. And we do it in such a way that the measure, so mu of omega N, is the same as mu tilde of omega N tilde. So the corresponding sets should have the same measure. And now I define the total mass as follows. So it's like a double integral. Always one integral is the measure mu tilde, the other is over the measure mu. And also one time I integrate over omega n or omega n tilde, and the other integral is over the complement of the set omega n or omega n tilde. So this is like a general structure here. And moreover, it is important that it's anti-symmetrized. And so anti-symmetrized in mu and mu tilde. So if you come from the first line to the second by replacing mu by mu tilde and vice versa, and of course then also omega n by omega n tilde and n by n tilde. So this is the mass, and let me explain a little bit how one should think of this. So suppose that this curly G is the whole blackboard here. And then we have the supports of the two measures. So this is the set N and the set N tilde. And one should think of them as being something like a submanifold of G. So like two surfaces, if you like. And then you have here the set omega N and the set omega N tilde. And if you look, for example, at the first integral here, then X tilde lies in omega N tilde. So this is the point down here. Whereas Y lies in the complement of omega N. So it lies in this green set here. Well, and then the second integral is the same with just omega and omega tilde replaced. Good, so this is like...
Felix, I have a question. is y on n. So the green part is really a part of the set n, or is it outside of n?
In fact, the y is always on n.
Okay.
Yeah, because n is the support of the measure. So outside of n, you just get zero.
Because you painted a whole region green that is also outside of n.
Okay, so maybe this was a bit misleading. So the y really also lies on this surface, and y tilde lies down here.
Okay, thank you.
Good, and now this structure is what we call a surface layer integral. Let me explain a little bit how this works. I mean, recall that the Lagrangian was assumed to have compact range. So this means, intuitively speaking, if x and y, if the two arguments here are too far apart, then the Lagrangian vanishes. Or in other words, we only get the contribution if the two arguments of the Lagrangian are sufficiently close together. So this means if you look, for example, here, this arrow here, so this means you only get a contribution if x lies close to y tilde, but this also means that they must both be close to the boundary of the corresponding region. So all the contributions to this double integral come from a region near the boundary of omega n, respectively omega n tilde. And in this sense, so these surface layer integrals, they generalize the notion of a surface integral to the setting which we consider here. Good. So, I mean, this is just a definition. And of course, you have to assume that the limit exists, and the limit should be independent of this exhaustion. So now let me explain how this comes about. And maybe first of all, it's kind of good to rewrite this surface layer integral in a somewhat different way. So let me explain how this goes. So this is the integrand, this double integral, which we just considered. And now we write a similar double integral, but we always integrate over omega n tilde, omega n, and omega n tilde, again with a minus sign. Well, now, since the Lagrangian is symmetric in its two arguments, these two expressions are the same, so we get zero. Now we can add the first line and the second line, and then you see that the only difference is the integration range here and the integration range here. So therefore, if you add this up, you get an integral over all of n here, and similarly all of n tilde here. So therefore, you can write this as a difference of two integrals, and this function n tilde here is just the integral over dy tilde, and the n of x is the other integral. So you can always carry out the integral over the whole measure space to define a function n tilde of x here, and similarly n of x here, and then it's a difference of two integrals over regions, so something like a volume term. So this omega n will be a region in space-time. And before, we had a surface layer integral, which corresponds to a surface integral, so an integral over a boundary of a spatial region. Here it's an integral over a spatial region. So in other words, we have converted a surface integral into a volume integral. So this transformation, I mean, it's quite simple, but it's very useful. This can be regarded as the analog of the Gauss divergence theorem in this setting, but it's all nonlinear. So nonlinear means that you can just start with two arbitrary measures, so they are not close to each other, or one cannot be obtained from the other by a linear transformation by a vector field. In fact, we will see a linear surface layer integral later on, then this will hopefully become clearer. Okay, now we have this kind of two difference of two integrals. And now we can also, so now we can write the total mass like this. And next we can use that the volumes of omega n and omega n tilde are the same. So this is how we constructed the exhaustion. So therefore, we can subtract here a constant, and we can subtract here the same constant. This simply drops out because well, you can carry out the integral here and you just get S times the volume of omega n tilde. And here similarly, S times the volume of omega n. And since these volumes are the same, nothing has changed. Good. And now we can all, provided that these new integrands are integrable, so if these functions are in L1 in the corresponding measure space, then we know that this limit exists and we simply get the limit over the integral over all of n tilde here and all of n here. And it's also clear the limit exists, is independent of the exhaustion, and then the mass gets a nicer form. And this leads to the notion of asymptotically closed. So we say that two measures, mu tilde and mu, are asymptotically closed if they are both sigma finite with infinite total volume. And for a suitable constant S, these integrals are finite. And in this case, the total mass is simply defined as this difference of integrals, each of which is finite. Good, so this is like the abstract way, so what the mass is. But of course, now you might wonder, well, why should this function here be integrable? And I mean, what does all of this mean? And as a first step of clarifying also why this, how this definition comes about and all of this, it is good to introduce a variational principle here. So what we do is, so we take this Lagrangian and we integrate this over both x and y. So this gives us a non-negative function, so the action. And now we minimize this action under variations of the measure in the class of all regular Borel measures, keeping the total volume fixed. So there's a volume constraint. So this is like the causal variational principle, which is underlying, which underlies the whole construction here. Well, in fact, the existence of minimizers is not an issue. So this was proved in this quite general non-compact setting just this year, together with Christoph Langer, a PhD student of mine. So we know that minimizers exist. Suppose we have a minimizer, then there are also corresponding Euler-Lagrange equations. And let me explain how they look like, and then I will explain you how they connect to the notion of the mass. So the Euler-Lagrange equations are stated in terms of the function little l, which maps g to the real numbers, and which is obtained simply by integrating one variable of the Lagrangian over n and subtracting a constant. And then the statement of the Euler-Lagrange equations is that for a suitable choice of this constant, the Lagrangian is minimal on the support, and this minimum is equal to zero. So the way to think of this is as follows. Suppose I draw G just in one dimensions, and I plot L on the y-axis. So then the function L is always bigger or equal to zero. And on the support of the measure, so on N, the function is identically equal to zero. So this is how it looks like. And these are the corresponding Euler-Lagrange equations. And I thought that, well, I don't want to present many proofs, but this is fairly easy and also illustrates a little bit how all this works. I thought that it's good to show you the proof of these Euler-Lagrange equations. So this works as follows. Suppose we take a point in the support, and then we can choose a neighborhood of this point, u, which has non-zero measure. So the measure is strictly positive. And also we can arrange it to be have finite measure. For example, we take u to be compact. Now we consider a variation of the measure where outside of u, we leave the measure as is, we don't change it. On the set u, we multiply it by a factor 1 minus tau. And moreover, we add a multiple of the Dirac measure at some point y in g, and this is multiplied here by the volume of u with a prefactor t, So in other words, it's like a convex combination of two measures here. So therefore it's again positive. So the tau is always between 0 and 1. So this is a positive measure, and the way it was done here, also the total volume is preserved. If you now write down the difference of the actions of, well, mu, S of mu tilde tau minus S of mu, then after rewriting the integrals, one sees that this is well-defined and finite. And moreover, since mu is a minimizer, we know that the first derivative of the action is non-negative, provided that this derivative exists, of course, but this is not an issue here because you can compute all of this, it's all well defined. Good, then you get a factor of 2 and you just vary one of the measures. Now, what does it mean here? You differentiate the measure. Well, you just differentiate here with respect to tau, and there's one term here, which is just the measure of mu times the Dirac measure. Well, if you get have the Dirac measure, then this integral here reduces to evaluating the remainder at the point y. So you simply get the function L of y time with the prefactor. And here you get a minus sign minus, I think this factor Ku in fact should be out. I'm sorry, this is a typo here. Then you get a minus the integral over this little L over the set U. And this whole expression should be non-negative. So you can solve this for L of y. You see that at any point y, the function L is bigger or equal to the mean of the function L over any set U of non-zero measure. And this implies that L is really minimal and constant on the support. So this gives precisely this picture here. Okay, so these are the Euler-Lagrange equations. And now let's see how this fits together with the notion of asymptotically closed, which at the beginning was a bit obscure. The point is that this function n minus s, which we have over here, where this is precisely the function little l, which we just introduced. So we can also write it like this. So measures are asymptotically closed if these integrals are finite. But now let's assume that both mu and mu tilde are minimizing measures. Then we just derive that the function L tilde is always bigger or equal to its value on N tilde, where this vanishes. And similarly, the other way around for the function L, this is minimal on N. So this means, first of all, that we could simply leave out the absolute values here because the function is non-negative anyhow. But moreover, one sees that the function vanishes. For example, if you look at the first integral, the function L tilde vanishes on X tilde. Well, now the X here is not on N tilde, it's on N. But if the two measures are asymptotically close in the sense that N and N tilde approach each other near infinity, then near infinity, the point x will be very close to a point on n tilde where the function l tilde vanishes. So therefore now the decay properties of these functions l and n tilde can be really understood by as a condition that n and n tilde should approach each other near infinity. Okay, so this is kind of the kind of abstract setting. Of course, we have to get the connection to spacetimes, Lorentzian manifolds and all of this. And let me explain how this goes kind of step by step. So we just begin with an example in a Lorentzian, a globally hyperbolic Lorentzian spacetime. And I want to construct a causal Fermion system in this spacetime, which kind of serves as an example to illustrate our notion of mass. And all this is based on Dirac spinners. So let me briefly recall how this goes. So again, we consider Lorentzian spacetime, four-dimensional, globally hyperbolic. So this is automatically a spin manifold. So we can introduce the spinner bundle. The fiber of the spinner bundle is a four-dimensional complex vector space. And we have an inner product on it called the spin inner product, which is indefinite of signature 2-2. And then there's, of course, the Dirac equation. Good. Now, having a globally hyperbolic spacetime, the Cauchy problem is well posed. So there are global smooth solutions of the Dirac equation. And we have finite propagation speed. So therefore, there is a nice space of solutions, namely spatially compact solutions. And on these solutions, one has a scalar product, which takes this form. So one integrates over any Cauchy surface here. And due to current conservation, what you get is independent of the choice of the Cauchy surface. And this is positive definite. So this defines your scalar product. And taking the completion, one gets a Hilbert space. So this is the solution space of the Dirac equation, the same which is always used in quantum mechanics, say in one particle, relativistic quantum mechanics. Okay, now in order to get to the causal fermion system setting, we choose a subspace of the solution space, for example, whatever finite dimensional subspace, for instance. And then one considers on this subspace a bilinear form or sesquilinear form by evaluating the spin scalar product at a given spacetime point x. So x is just like a point on the manifold. And then we have here a sesquilinear form on H. And then we can represent this sesquilinear form in terms of an operator on the Hilbert space. Or in other words, we can represent it as the signature operator relative to the scalar product of the Hilbert space. So this relation here defines us this operator f of x as a symmetric operator, which is self-adjoint, has rank at most 4, and has at most 2 positive and at most 2 negative eigenvalues. So the number of positive and negative eigenvalues reflects the signature of this spin inner product. Good. And now this was maybe a bit too simple to take here a finite number of wave functions. It turns out if you want to consider infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces, then this pointwise evaluation may not be well defined because these are only L2 functions or something like that. And to this end, one needs to introduce an ultraviolet regularization. So this is, for example, a mollifying operator, smoothing operator, which maps the Hilbert space to the continuous sections. And there's a certain length parameter coming up here. So the regularization scale, which you can think of as a very small length scale, for example, the Planck scale. So everything is kind of smeared out on a microscopic scale. And in this way, these local correlation operators are well defined. Good. So this means this local correlation operator at any space-time point X is an operator in the set curly F, which we define as follows. So these are all the linear operators which are self-adjoint, have rank at most 4, and have at most 2 positive and at most 2 negative eigenvalues. And so what we end up with is a mapping from our Lorentzian spacetime to curly F. So to any spacetime point, we associate the corresponding local correlation operator. And well, now we are almost done. We also need a measure on curly F, and we simply take the push forward measure. So the push forward measure, so this works as follows. Suppose you take a subset U of curly F, then you take its pre-image. So this gives you a subset of the Lorentzian manifold, and then you take the usual volume measure on the manifold of the set. And this is what you take as a definition of the push forward measure. So in this way, one gets a measure on curly F, and the support of this measure is precisely the closure of the image of this mapping F. And our basic idea behind this causal fermion system approach is that we want to disregard all the structures on the left. So we want to work exclusively with the structures here on the right. So we want to work only with this measure rho on the set curly F, which consists of specific operators on a Hilbert space. Okay, now let me give you the abstract definition. So this is what a causal Fermat system is. So one has a Hilbert space given a parameter n, the spin dimension. In our example, the spin dimension was 2. Then we define curly F as the set of all linear operators which are self-adjoint, have finite rank, have at most n positive and at most n negative eigenvalues. Maybe I should have said we always count these eigenvalues with multiplicities. And finally, rho is a measure on curly F. Okay. Now we have to go one step further because I only consider the static situation. So how do we specialize this to the static situation? Well, first of all, we start with a static globally hyperbolic space-time. Well, and in this case, also the support of the measure has a splitting. So basically like this foliation carries over to the subset of curly F. And also the push forward measure can be decomposed like this, can be written as dt d nu, where mu is a measure on one of these leaves. So we simply define n as the support of this measure. So this is how we describe static Lorentzian spacetimes, and then the corresponding causal Fermat systems are also static. There's also a way of understanding static causal Fermat systems more abstractly by considering a unitary group, one parameter unitary group on the Hilbert space. And then we restrict attention to measures which are symmetric under the action of this group in the following sense. And then the set G, which appeared at the very beginning of my talk, are simply the orbits of this group action, or in other words, F modulo the action of this group. And once we are in this setting, then there's an explicit static Lagrangian, and we get this causal variational principle, which I mentioned earlier. And I decided, in order to avoid too many formulas, I will show you more details a little bit later. So in any case, so there's such a Lagrangian, and now we are in the setting which we had at the beginning, and can ask the question, well, what is the correspondence to the ADM mass? And this is obtained as follows. So we consider a causal Fermat system describing the Minkowski vacuum. So more precisely, we consider all negative energy solutions. So H is composed of all negative energy solutions, and we regularize on a scale epsilon. I mean, this is, well, in fact, I explained this a little bit in more detail yesterday in my talk. Now we do the similar construction in a static asymptotically Schwarzschild space-time. And then we get H tilde, F tilde, rho tilde. So all these causal Fermat systems are static. So we get corresponding measures mu and mu tilde. Okay, but the next step is we have to identify the two Hilbert spaces unitarily. And the way we have to do it in such a way that the measures become asymptotically close in the way I defined it earlier. This can actually be done, but this still leaves some freedom in identifying the Hilbert spaces. But it turns out that the remaining freedom is irrelevant for the mass. So the mass does not depend on how you identify these Hilbert spaces as long as you do it in such a way that the measures are asymptotically close. And then the theorem is that the total mass of the causal fermion system is the same, is a constant times the ADM mass, where this constant is something you can compute here. It's given in terms of the Lagrangian in Euclidean space. Okay, so this is like just a correspondence to the ADM mass. I don't know, is this clear, or are there any questions? I mean, just feel free to interrupt me, as I said.
Yes, I have a question. Again, if I may. Stop me if I'm asking too many questions. My question is, in the Schwarzschild space-time, what did you use as the Hilbert space? Did you also use the kind of the Dirac C?
Exactly. So in Schwarzschild, I mean, since it's static, I can separate the time dependence with a plane wave. So e to the minus I omega t, and then the sine of omega tells me whether the energy is positive or negative, and then I simply take all the negative energy solutions. Again, with a regularization on the scale epsilon. In effect, the two regularization scales must be compatible, which means that these parameters little s, which appeared earlier, they must be the same for the two spacetimes.
Thank you.
Okay, but now let me say a few words on the proof. And in fact, like the proof is rather computational. So this is why I think it wouldn't be a good idea to show it to you in detail. But let me just say a few words on this. So we had this volume constraint at the beginning. So the volume of omega n must be the same as the volume of omega n tilde. So this is volume constraint is really important. And it has the consequence that kind of the leading contribution to each of these integrals, so we have this difference of these two integrals, drops out. So the leading contribution is the one which scales like this parameter little s. After doing this, then it remains to compute the next two leading order proportional to C. So C is this constant which we had on the previous slide. Let me see. So this constant C is like what tells us about the scaling of the ADM mass. So we need to compute this. And now it turns out that this is independent of the volumes of the inner regions. So this is as it should be. So it depends really only on the metric near infinity, so the metric on these big spheres. And it can be described by a linear surface layer integral, where simply if the sphere is very large, the gravitational field is very weak, and therefore you can rewrite the surface layer integral in such a way. So here we simply take the Minkowski measures, but here there's a vector field. So we have like derivatives of the Lagrangian here. So it's a vector field on Tg along n. And this is what I call a linear surface layer integral. And this is something which can be computed using perturbative methods, so particular linearized gravity. This is still not so easy because you have to compute all the Dirac wave functions perturbatively. Then one has to compute first variations of the Lagrangian. I mean, the derivatives here can be understood as variational derivatives of the Lagrangian. And finally, one computes the surface layer integral asymptotically on large spheres, and this gives the result. Good. So this just shows that there is a correspondence. So in other words, that in a certain limiting case, our total mass agrees with the ADM mass. But of course, we want to understand more. I mean, also, like, for example, how do the Einstein equations come into play? And what is a positive mass theorem and all of that? And to this end, I have to explain you a bit more about the variational principle. So what I didn't-
Just one question. Maybe one question. Could you say a word what the Lagrangian is in this example of asymptotic Schwarzschild?
So this is precisely what I want to explain here.
Okay.
Because I didn't do it because there are many formulas and so on. So it might be a bit scary if you see it right away, right from the beginning. This variation principle is set up as follows. Suppose we take two points in curly F. So then these are two linear operators, self-adjoint of rank at most 2n, with at most two positive and at most two negative eigenvalues. So we can multiply these two operators. This gives again an operator of rank at most 2n, but this operator will no longer be symmetric, because if you take the adjoint of x times y, you get y times x, which is not equal to x times y, unless the operators commute, which is not the case in general. This means so we have a non-symmetric operator of finite rank, and then we can compute its eigenvalues, or more precisely, we can compute the zero of the characteristic polynomial with algebraic multiplicities. And this gives us at most 2n non-zero numbers. So some of these eigenvalues could still be zero. More precisely, if the rank is smaller than 2n, then some of these eigenvalues are zero. But we always arrange it, we always choose 2n eigenvalues, and I call them non-trivial because they could, at least all the other eigenvalues are zero. Okay, so now we have these two n complex numbers for any pair of space-time points x and y. And the Lagrangian is obtained by taking the absolute values of these eigenvalues, taking their differences, squaring it, and summing over all the eigenvalues. So this gives you a negative, non-negative number, which still depends on the pair of points x and y. Now we integrate over these points. So we integrate over rho and so we integrate both x and y over the measure rho. And this gives us a non-negative number, which we call the action. Now the causal action principle is to minimize this action under variations of the measure rho under suitable constraints. Namely the volume constraint, so the total volume is fixed. Trace constraints, so the integral over the trace is fixed. And finally, a boundedness constraint. And these constraints are needed in order to get a well-posed minimization problem. So this means that you have existence of minimizers and the minimizers are non-trivial. So this is like the basic variation principle which we consider all the time. Now in the static case, all of this simplifies. Let me explain how this works. So we choose this unitary group right from the beginning. So unitary group acting on the Hilbert space. And then we vary only in the class of static measures. In other words, measures which are where this unitary group acts as a symmetry group. Measures which are invariant under the action of this group. The next step is that we treat the boundedness constraint with a Lagrange multiplier. This can in fact be done. So this means we take the Lagrangian and add a constant, kappa is a Lagrange multiplier here, times the integrand of the boundedness constraint. And then the static causal action principle is, well, just as we had it before, where the static Lagrangian is obtained from the Lagrangian in space time L kappa over here by integrating over once over time. So I mean, everything is static, so therefore you can choose the T0 as you like, it doesn't matter. And then you integrate in the other argument, you integrate over the real line, so over all of time. And this gives you a Lagrangian, which depends only now on your spatial coordinates, x and y. And then there's the corresponding action, like a static action, which is the one I showed you at the very beginning. So this is how it works. I mean, of course, if you see it for the first time, it's a bit overwhelming. And it took a lot of time to come up with this specific action. But I'm convinced that this is the correct way to do it. And also, I mean, I should say the detailed form is not so important, but one thing is important, namely this Lagrange multiplier term. So there's a Lagrange multiplier here, and the Lagrange multiplier kappa is a dimensionless parameter. So this is really like physically meaningful quantity. I should say that the constants here, the volume and trace constraint, they can all be arranged by rescaling. So they have no physical significance. But suppose you fix these scalings of volume and trace constraint, the third quantity here, so this capital C. So this really has a physical significance. And likewise, the kappa, so the corresponding Lagrange multiplier also has a significance. And this will be important for what comes next. Good, namely, let me now explain how this positive mass theorem works. So the point is that we now consider this kappa as a variable parameter. So we assume that there we not only have one minimizing measure mu, but that we have a whole family of minimizing measures which are parameterized by kappa. And the way to think of this is like if you have a physical system and then you change this parameter kappa, this means that you change the masses and the regularization length in your system slightly. And as a consequence, like the gravitational coupling changes a little bit, and then the whole system changes slightly. But the assumption here is that still you get a minimizer. So for each value of kappa in a small interval, I assume that there is a minimizer. So this is like the assumption here. This is what this kappa extendable means. So that there is a whole family, which is of a specific form. Maybe that's not so important here. And once I have this family of measures, I can also consider the infinitesimal generator of this family, which is now a vector field, again, on Tg along n. So in other words, I have a way of describing the variation of the measure in the direction of this change of kappa by a vector field. Okay. And now I assume that both the Minkowski vacuum measure as well as the measure describing my asymptotically Schwarzschild spacetime or asymptotically flat spacetime are kappa scalable in this sense. And then the mass can again be written as before, like with this linear surface layer integral, but the vector field W coming up here it's a multiple of the difference of V tilde and V. So there's a parameter coming up here, which I call the gravitational coupling constant. It's more something like how the coupling changes if you change the system infinitesimally by varying the parameter kappa. So this is like how this works. And then the total mass can be written as follows. So namely g times, and then you have here the integral over L tilde minus L at infinity, and you integrate this over space time. So this means now you have something like a linear expression for the mass, which you can interpret in a simple way. Namely, well, if you compute this L infinity in the vacuum, then you simply get in the vacuum, this function L is constant. It's kind of clear because everything is homogeneous. If you are in curved space-time, the function L will no longer be constant. And it turns out, well, that it will typically be bigger in the interior. So it will have a value at infinity, L tilde infinity. And inside it will typically be bigger. And this is something you can compute. I mean, so you can like take an energy momentum tensor, you compute the corresponding L tilde, and then you see, okay, if the kind of dominant energy condition is fulfilled, then this L tilde is really bigger than in the vacuum. So this is why it makes sense to call this mu tilde. To associate the sign of this integrand with a local energy condition. Then we say that mu tilde satisfies the local energy condition if this L tilde is bigger or equal to its value at infinity in all of space. And if you assume that this condition holds and the gravitational constant G is positive, then you see right away from here that the mass is non-negative. So in some sense, the positive mass theorem is a kind of a trivial state, consequence of this formula. Okay, and therefore, therefore I wanted to say a few more words on this formula because this seems kind of important to me. Also, it's somewhat at the heart of what to me the positive mass theorem is. And kind of maybe first of all, from a more technical point of view. So we consider kind of linear perturbations of the system, in this case parameterized by kappa. And also keep in mind that the system is described by solutions of a Dirac equation. So we consider something like linear perturbations of a whole system. This is then described by linear perturbations of a Dirac equation. And then from a technical point of view, this is very similar to what you have in Witten's proof of the positive mass theorem. So that one also works with spinners, and there's a somewhat similar formula where the total mass is the integral over nabla psi square plus scalar curvature over 4 times psi square, something like this. So there's also a way to express the mass as an integral over all of space over a certain quantity. But now there's a difference concerning the interpretation of this quantity. I mean, for the Witten spinner, this quantity is very non-local and it's not appropriate to interpret it as the mass density, for example. This would be too simple. But here the situation is different, and the reason is that we do not consider just one Dirac wave function. Instead, we consider a whole family and also Dirac solutions of high frequencies. So high frequency means that everything becomes more local, and therefore this function L tilde can really be interpreted as a local density, something like a local energy density. So this is how this can be under, at least how I understand this from a kind of more, well, technical and also conceptual point of view. And I want to point out that so there are no smoothness assumptions here. So the definition of total mass works even for discrete space times or generalized quantum space times, whatever this is. And well, I mean, this already brings me to my last slide on outlook. Well, yeah, of course, there are many things to be done, but I mean, there are a few obvious open questions. I mean, one question concerns the rigidity. So, I mean, in the positive mass theorem, in this classical positive mass theorem, there's a statement, if the mass is zero, then the Riemannian manifold is Euclidean. So then there's no curvature. Here we have a statement which looks a little bit similar, but it's much weaker. So the statement if the total mass is zero, then this function little l is constant. Again, this is like an obvious from here. So I mean, like if this the mass is zero and this local energy condition is fulfilled, then this integrand must be identically equal to zero. So, but then the question is like, which measures have this property? Obviously, Minkowski space has this property, but are there other space times which have this property? Are they unique, maybe up to some scalings or whatever? In which sense are they unique? So this is a big open problem, which has to do with the general difficulty, which I also mentioned yesterday in my talk. It's not clear how minimizers of the causal action principle look like in general, even if you make symmetry assumptions or whatever. Well, then there's another open problem, of course. I mean, we only consider the static case. What happens in the time-dependent setting? So then this should be kind of more, so it should be richer. So there should be total momentum, total energy, like a positive energy theorem. And in fact, this is ongoing work with one of my PhD students, Johannes Wurm. Then, of course, well, since Mr. Hüsken, since you are here, of course, I should mention, what about Penrose inequalities? Because it would be nice to show that the mass is not only positive, but it's bigger than whatever the area of an interior minimal surface. But it turns out that this is difficult, and I have no plan how to do this. One basic difficulty is that the methods here are a bit similar or inspired by spinorial methods. But also with spinorial methods, it's not clear how to prove the Penrose inequalities. I mean, there are results by Mark Herzley, something like 20, 25 years ago, but they do not get optimal results. And the basic problem is that it's not clear how to specify this outermost condition with spinners. So outermost condition means you have a minimal surface and there's no other minimal surface around this minimal surface. And basically, the spinner doesn't see if a minimal surface is outermost or not. So this is the reason why there's a general limitation at the moment, why I don't know how to do anything in this direction of Penrose inequality. But there is some work which is related to area and like whatever surfaces in space-time. Then we want to analyze the connection between area and black hole entropy or entropy in general. So this is ongoing work with Eric Curiel, Jose Isidro, and Magdalena Lottner, another PhD student of mine. Okay, so this somehow is all what I wanted to say. I see the timing is almost perfect. And as I said at the beginning, I mean, of course, I couldn't really give you like a complete picture. And if you want to see more or understand this better, I mean, I think the what I recommend is to go to our web pages where we try to explain things like on different levels for different people, for mathematicians, physicists, the general audience. So I hope that you will like it. Of course, any feedback is welcome. And well, I think with this, I want to close and thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much. I'm sure there's many questions. If you would like to ask a question, I think you should be able to unmute yourself. If something doesn't work with the microphone, you can also use the chat and I can read it to Felix Finster.
I do have a question. Can I ask it? So I was wondering about, if you look at the spinners in the case of supergravity, where there are vector valued spinners, I was just wondering if there's any sense in which this formalism would apply for that, so that sort of fermionic system.
Okay, it's a good question. I mean, of course, like this fermionics looks a little bit like supersymmetry, but honestly, I don't know how to do it. I mean, for the moment, it's also just four dimensions, the standard setting. So if you add extra dimensions, supersymmetry or whatever, I don't know how to do it.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
I wouldn't make any predictions. I think a lot can be done, for example, in higher dimensions and so on, but up to now, always restricted attention to four dimensions and the simplest setting, also the physical setting, at least from my point of view.
But you can think about supergravity and not in extra dimensions, just where the fermions are vector valued.
Probably yes, but I don't know right now. I don't know how to do it.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sorry.
The other question. Well, then let ask me a question. Your formulation of the positivity assumption, L tilde of x greater or equal than L infinity, could you just in a few words explain how that relates to the non-negative scalar curvature condition that you usually have in the classical formulation of the positive mass theorem?
I see. No, in fact, let's see. I mean, somewhere am I now? Okay, here.
Yeah.
Like, okay, so I mean, like, well, honestly, not. So I don't know. Also, I mean, there's a major difference concerning the kind of the Riemannian setting and the setting here. This is also something which took us quite some time to understand. Namely, the measure mu here, this is not the same, like in the examples, it's not the same as the induced Riemannian measure, the induced measure of the Riemannian manifold. And the reason is that here we do not take the induced Riemannian metric and the corresponding volume form. Instead, we write the measure as dt d mu. Maybe I should switch to the whiteboard to my. Let's just try to do that. Let's see if this works out. Okay, good. Thailand. Okay, so now you should see my screen.
Yep.
So I mean here the so we have this space-time volume, so measure d rho, which really corresponds to the usual determinant of g square root d4x. So they really they correspond to each other. But now we decompose the d rho as dt d mu. So therefore this d mu is again the square root of the four dimensional, the determinant of the four dimensional metric d3x, which is of course not the same as the square root of that of whatever we call this here. So this is now the induced Riemannian metric d3x. This is really different because I mean, like when Andreas started with his PhD thesis, we had precisely your formulation with this isoparametric constant in mind. So we looked at volumes and areas and tried to compare them, but somehow it never really worked out. And well, my conclusion is that in this causal Fermion system setting, this doesn't, it's different simply because our measure is not the same measure. And well, in fact, this measure d mu here has a kind of nice property, or say if you look at the determinant of g in Schwarzschild,
yes,
and the mass drops out. So this is simply the same as, what is it, r squared d cosine theta dr d phi, something like this. So it's just like the volume measure in Minkowski space in polar coordinates, because of there's this factor, and then the factor one over this, and when you take the determinant, this drops out.
Okay.
So this is therefore this is like the measure we are working with. So the spatial measure in our case is really just, although we are in Schwarzschild space-time, it is the usual measure in Minkowski space. And this is important for kind of identifying these spheres and so on.
Right.
And similarly, also like concerning now the scalar curvature, I mean, the scalar curvature is like the scalar curvature coming from this metric H here.
Right.
But since the kind of the induced Riemannian metric doesn't come into play, neither does the corresponding scalar curvature.
In the Witten proof, the scalar curvature comes in as a commutator for the Lichtenrohrwitz Laplacian.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, like in the Witten proof, there's this d square is whatever minus nabla squared or minus nabla star nabla plus, and then there's here scalar curvature over four, something like this.
So I guess the question is whether in your theory it can be somehow, whether this inequality on L tilde can be somehow interpreted as a commutator property of some operator. So it's,
what that I know of. I mean, okay. This L is also kind of, it's more non-local. I mean, this L of X is the integral of L of XY, d rho Y. So you integrate, and then you integrate here over all of space-time, so something like this. Okay, and then if you perturb here the measure, so if you have some fields and particles, whatever, then the measure here changes, and this affects this L. But there is no way of writing, at least I don't see, of a way of writing this in terms of commutators or similar to this Witten proof term here. So it seems different.
Okay.
Which is in some sense also nice because it is more local. I mean, so this L of XY, this decays on the scale one over, on the Compton scale.
Okay.
So this sense, this L is really like a more local quantity than in the Witten proof. I mean, in the Witten proof, like the total, the ADM mass is something like the integral over nabla psi square plus scalar curvature over four times psi square, and then d mu n, something like this. Okay, and then, but then the psi here is a solution globally in your space. So therefore, talking of this, I mean, calling this an energy density doesn't make sense, because if you have like a localized, like a charge density somewhere, well, then this affects the psi also for large distances.
But this term is also the reason I think that the proof of the Penrose inequality doesn't work, because you have an L2 norm of the gradient of psi, whereas the area would be more like an L1 norm of the gradient rather than
okay,
an L2 norm. I think that's
the another way of seeing the problem. I mean, yeah. Also, as I said, the problem is like with this, if you have a situation like this, I mean, so then
yeah,
it's not clear how to distinguish an outermost horizon from an interior horizon.
Right.
So, but I mean, you are right. I mean, there are several reasons why these spinners don't seem appropriate for the Penrose inequalities. And this is why, for the moment, I'm also pessimistic on whether one could extend our methods to prove some Penrose-like inequalities, which would, of course, be very nice. But as I said, that's not also not our main focus because it seems too difficult for the moment.
I had one more question, and that was about, you had a comment that there was some freedom in identifying the Hilbert space, the asymptotically flat setting. Does that have to do with translation invariance near infinity? Can that freedom be removed if you have a concept of center of mass?
Okay, maybe I just go back to the slides now. I see, you can, okay, I have to, let's see, I have to stop it here. Okay, and now I can again share my screen. Okay, and then let me go back to, so this is when I identified things.
Right.
Exactly here. So we have like two causal Fermion systems, and a priori they are defined on different Hilbert spaces. One is the solution space in the Minkowski vacuum, and the other is solution space of the Dirac equation in curved space-time. So now you have to identify them, and well, and you can always identify two Hilbert spaces unitarily. So just construct an isomorphism between the Hilbert spaces, but this is defined only up to unitary transformations of the Hilbert spaces. And then we were puzzled, and then we were, well, this took a while to understand what's going on here. And in the end, it turns out that if you change the identification of H and I, H2, if you change this unitary transformation, then you get, then you can describe this infinitesimally by some commutators. But it turns out that they drop out of the surface layer integrals.
Okay. I see.
Well, I mean, if you want to, well, then I can also show it to you on the, in the paper, if you like, if you want to see it in more detail.
No. So you say it doesn't, I realized it doesn't make any difference for the computation. I was just thinking whether nevertheless, sort of this non-uniqueness, which might be in itself an interesting point, whether that can be removed if you fix the center of gravity of the system.
Okay, this might be. I mean, I don't know. I mean, right now there is just this freedom in identifying the Hilbert spaces. And for example, this corresponds to kind of translations of the system. So I mean, like the, well, Minkowski space, of course, translation invariant. So you can realize translations by unitary transformations. And these are this is part of the freedom you have in identifying.
Okay, there may be more. Okay.
Yeah. There are also rotations, and there might be even more.
Again. Right. Any other questions?
Maybe I have one. You mentioned like that there's not really a correspondence of this small l to the scalar curvature because it's an integral, or you cannot really express this in terms of commutators. Is there a way to see it for the Lagrangian density, for the big L, so that the small L can be seen as kind of a mean over some commutators or something like, which can be interpreted in terms of the scalar curvature?
I don't know. Well, I mean, this little L is like, I mean, sometimes it's the mean of this capital L. I mean, if you integrate this capital L over one of the variables, you get the little L.
That's right, yeah.
But, well, that's all I can say. I don't have a geometric feeling of what's going on there. I mean, for example, you think of yesterday's talk, I mentioned that there's connection curvature and all of this, but I don't see how these notions fit together with what we are doing here. This means I can't express this little L in terms of this holonomy, which we had yesterday, for example. In fact, we tried this for a while, but so far it didn't work out.
And also not for the big L.
No, also exactly, also not for the bigger. This is also something we I wanted to do for some time. I wanted to expand the Lagrangian in some sense, and then you get then you get scalar curvature, and you say, okay, now this is like the Einstein-Hilbert action, and then I get maybe the Maxwell Lagrangian, and say, okay, this is why I had to get Maxwell equations. But it doesn't seem to be so easy. So therefore, in order to get the way we proceed always is we first derive the Euler-Lagrange equations of the causal action, and then we analyze those. For example, in the continuum limit, a bit similar to what I explained yesterday. But there is no way that you can, or at least it didn't work out so far, that you take the Lagrangian, you do some approximations or expansions, and then you get something like the classical Lagrangian out of this directly. This doesn't seem to work. And it might be related to the fact, one of the problems is what happens with the constraints? I mean, these constraints are important, but how do you translate them if you want to take something like a classical limit of the causal action principle?
Okay, thanks.
But I mean, okay, I mean, this is just like the present status. I mean, if you have an idea, I would be happy. I mean, I tried it too, but so far without success.
Yep, thanks again.
Let me mention something else. So there's a project for collected works of
Jim, are you still there?
Yeah, Bob, sorry.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, Robert Bondic. Yeah, put together by Yao and Bill Kushel and me. Mm-hmm. And we're looking for comments on some of the various papers. Yeah, Robert Bondic, so if any of you have any comments on papers of Robert Bondic that you would like to have included, please send them to Yao or me.
This is like in this, what is it, PAMQ journal, isn't it? Like this Pure and Applied Mathematics Quarterly. This is where
I'm not sure where it's going to be published, but it would be
on
the collected Bartnick works of Robert Bondic. So if you if there's some of his papers which have been very influential for you, would like to write a couple of paragraphs of comments on them, that'd be very welcome.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thanks for mentioning that, Jim. I was thinking of maybe writing a little bit about the quasi-local mass paper where he suggests the four properties of quasi-local mass. And
that'd be wonderful, yeah.
I could write a little bit about that, yeah.
Yeah, any of you who have comments of some sort like that, that'd be very much appreciated. Thank you.
Let me ask one last sort of very general question. You gave us sort of the fermionic picture approach to positive mass. Have you heard of anyone trying to sort of give a bosonic point of view?
Not that I know of. I mean, here really the approach is based on all these fermionic wave functions, and also that these fermionic wave functions, Dirac C encodes the geometry, and this is really gives all the space-time structures. I don't know if something similar could be done with bosons. I'm skeptical, but of course.
Okay, so nobody has tried.
But of course, I mean, why not? I mean.
Yeah, okay. Lots of open problems. Okay. Any other question, comment? Well, if that's not the case, then thank you very much again for a very interesting lecture and discussion.
Well, thank you very much for your interest.
And I think we have a talk again next Thursday in our seminar, and hope to see many of you again next Thursday. And thanks again to Felix Finzer, and bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.